Intel 11th Gen Tiger Lake processors are here for gaming laptops, and Nvidia have also announced RTX 3050 and 3050 Ti graphics for laptops as well. So let's start out with the Intel news, then Nvidia news after. Now, Intel's 11th Gen Tiger Lake processors for laptops have been here for a few months now. However, these were for lower powered variants that only went up to 4 cores. This launches what's known as H45, so 6 and 8 core parts with higher power limits too. So the stuff you'd find in gaming laptops. Basically the 11th Gen chips that'll replace the 10th Gen parts like i7-10750H or i9-10980HK, for example. Intel are claiming that these new 10nm 11th Gen Tiger Lake parts offer 19% gen-on-gen IPC gains to multi-threaded performance when compared to 10th Gen, and 12% IPC gains to single-threaded performance. Along with Thunderbolt 4, these new chips are also offering 20 lanes of PCIe Gen 4. This means that the OEM could choose to dedicate either 8 or 16 PCIe 4 lanes to discrete graphics, while AMD Ryzen 5000, on the other hand, seems to be limited to 8 lanes of PCIe 3 for the GPU. Likewise, Intel 11th Gen systems can take advantage of faster PCIe Gen 4 storage, while again, Ryzen 5000 is limited to PCIe 3 there. These are the new processors that will be available in laptops from May 17th. This generation, 6 cores is the minimum, which is good to see, and those make up the i5 lineup with the wonderfully named i5-11-2060H and i5-11-400H processors. Finally, no more quad cores, unless they plan on introducing these later or something. Stepping up from that, there's just one i7 part at the moment, the 11800H, which has 8 cores and 16 threads. This has 50% more L3 cache compared to the 16MB found in the 10th Gen i7-10875H from last generation. Another welcome change, and it's also worth noting AMD's Ryzen 7 5800H also has 16MB of L3 cache, so now Intel has the lead here. The clock speeds differ though. The i7-11800H has a single core turbo speed of 4.6 GHz, while the last gen i7-10875H was 500 MHz higher with a 5.1 GHz single core boost. Intel says that they've been able to make up the ground with IPC gains, despite 11th gen appearing to clock lower than 10th gen. This is also seen at the top of the stack with the i9s. The 11980HK has a 5.0 GHz single core turbo, while last generation the 10980HK could boost up to 5.3 GHz. But despite this, Intel says the other improvements give a nice boost to 11th gen. It's not all about clock speed. The memory speed of this generation has also been boosted to DDR4 3200, so the same as AMD's Ryzen 5000. No need for overclocking to hit it, which I think was only possible with 10th gen's 8 core processors. Just briefly, these are the new mobile processors that we'll see in workstation style laptops, and these offer the usual extras like ECC memory support and various enterprise security features. Now let's check out some benchmarks, but keep in mind that these were all done by Intel, so take the results with a grain of salt until we can get these parts in for testing. You'll definitely want to make sure you're subscribed for when these 11th gen machines start coming in for review. Here's how the top end i9 chips compare between 10th and 11th generations. And it's worth noting that Intel have specified the GPU power limits at the bottom of the slides, which is a welcome addition, both of which in this case had 155 watt RTX 3080s. Now here's how these same selection of games differ between AMD's Ryzen 9 5900HX and the Intel i9-11980HK. Again, I need to run my own suite of games on both to compare, but Intel are saying they're slightly ahead in these titles. Intel also compared the ASUS Zephyrus G14 with Ryzen 9 5900HS against an Intel system with apparently lower GPU power limit, showing the i5-11400H with fewer cores putting up a fight. Honestly, I don't find it too surprising to see Intel claiming a win over AMD's Ryzen 5000 in gaming, given I've already shown that Intel 10th gen can still beat AMD today. Intel provided a few content creation style comparisons, but there wasn't much. Nothing like Cinebench or anything like that. So I'm curious if that means that AMD still has an edge in those multi-core rendering style workloads and they didn't want to show it.
The i9-11980HK processor is also fully unlocked like previous generations, so you get full voltage control and you can modify things like clock speed. Now this is in contrast to AMD's Ryzen 9 5900HX. They said that's supposed to be unlocked, but that doesn't quite appear to be the case, at least for now. Every laptop that I've had with that processor, best case, just lets you modify the power limit of the CPU. Things like clock speed and voltage control aren't available either through software or the BIOS. I'm not sure if that'll change, but from what I've heard so far, it sounds like the power limit control is all we're gonna get. So for those CPU overclocking enthusiasts, the Intel HK processor might be the way to go. As for availability, Intel says that 1 million systems have already shipped to OEMs for launch, so hopefully there's some decent stock out there, as that was an issue for AMD's Ryzen 5000 at launch, and to some degree is still an issue today. That said, it's honestly hard to say whether or not 1 million units is a lot. I've got no clue, and those things are going to be spread out all over the world. If Intel's IPC gains turn out to be true, combined with the additional cache on the 8-core processors, along with the boost to DDR4 3200 memory as a default, and of course the faster PCIe Gen 4, well, let's just say AMD might have a challenge on their hands. Alright, now let's move over into the Nvidia news.
We're getting two new GPUs for laptops, the RTX 3050 and RTX 3050 Ti, and this is how they compare against the rest of the 30 series lineup. The difference between the Ti and non-Ti is in the core counts and clock speeds. Both have 4GB of VRAM like the GTX 1650, but at least it's GDDR6 memory here. Additionally, the power limit range is between 35 and 80 watts, higher than the 35 to 50 watts of the GTX 1650. There isn't currently any news on whether or not the GTX lineup will continue, so it may be the case that the 3050 replaces the 1650 this generation with a focus on ray tracing only GPUs for laptops. We'll have to wait and see. How well the 3050 does in actual ray tracing is yet to be seen, but I can't imagine it going too well on the lower side of that power limit range. In any case, outside of ray tracing, this will still be beneficial by bringing features like DLSS to more people in the mid-range, as unlike ray tracing, this at least aims to boost performance, and many games are actually offering this feature now. We didn't get too much information from Nvidia in terms of performance. In this example, there are just a couple of games that actually have data points for the GTX 1650 Ti, outlining how the new GPUs compare. It's at zero for the other three games because it doesn't support ray tracing. Otherwise, esports titles are at least looking good based on Nvidia's numbers provided, but I'll have these new laptops soon enough to test with for myself, so stay tuned. Nvidia says that pricing will start from $799 US, so I'd assume that to be a lower end RTX 3050 model, so probably lower storage, memory, or a lower tier screen in order to hit the lower price point. That's just my guess though. I'm definitely happy to be proven wrong and hope we see great options for that amount. Nvidia also mentioned these new laptops coming to market. The MSI GS76, a 17-inch version of the GS66, is arriving here soon for review, and I'll have a video covering the new Zephyrus M16 up tomorrow.
Considering how well RTX 2060 laptops did in ray tracing, especially the lower powered Max-Q variants, it's hard to say how well the 3050 is going to do. In my opinion, the 2060 just wasn't great for ray tracing, so it'll be interesting if the 3050 does beat it, and it'll be especially interesting if it's actually useful in ray tracing. Again, make sure you're subscribed for my upcoming comparisons. I've got laptops with RTX 3050, 3050 Ti, and 3060 graphics in the same chassis for a fair comparable result coming from XMG soon. You definitely won't want to miss that one.